أعوذ بالله من الشيطان اللعين الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله الذي لا يبلغ مدحته القائلون ولا يؤدي حقه المجتهدون ولا يحصي نعماءه العادون ولا يدركه بعد الهمم ولا يناله غوص الفتن الذي بعد فلا يرى وقرب فشهد النجوى تبارك وتعالى وصلى الله على أشرف بريته وسيد رسله وخاتم أنبيائه ومبلغ رسالته وبشير نعمته ونذير نقمته وعبده المؤيد ورسوله المسدد المصطفى الأمجد أبي القاسم محمد.
اللهم صل على محمد
وآل بيته الطيبين الطاهرين المعصومين المظلومين الغر الميامين الذين أذهب الله عنهم الرجس وطهرهم تطهيرا.
اللهم صل على محمد وعلى آله.
ولعنة الله الأبدية الدائمة على أعدائهم أعداء الله من الآن إلى قيام يوم الدين. أما بعد، فقد قال الله سبحانه وتعالى في كتابه الحكيم وهو أصدق القائلين: بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. لقد كتبنا في الزبور من بعد الذكر إن الأرض يرثها عبادي الصالحين. صلوات
اللهم صل على محمد وعلى محمد.
السلام على المهدي الذي وعد الله به الأمم أن يجمع به الكلم ويلم به الشعث ويملأ به الأرض قسطا وعدلا ويمكن له وينجز به وعد المؤمنين. صلوات
اللهم صل على محمد وعلى محمد.
سلام عن مهدي. Who Allah has promised that through him will gather the nations with diversity of their discourse and words, and who will remove their muddled affairs through him, and who will fill the earth with peace and justice via him and make him firm. وَيُمَكِّنَ لَهُ and make him firm in earth, and through him he will fulfill the promises of the mu'mineen and believers. صلوات على محمد وعلى محمد.
اللهم
brothers and sisters, last night we started discussion about concept of Mahdi. And we said overwhelming number of verses of Holy Quran speaks about final victory of Islam. Final victory of truth. As the final destiny of Anbiya and Mursaleen. لِيُذْهِرَهُ عَلَى الدِّينِ كُلِّهِ. And he will make his deen to prevail on every other deen and religion. Overwhelmingly number of verses speak about victory of oppressed over oppressors. ونريد أن نمن على الذين استضعفوا في العالم. Desire of Allah belongs to victory of those who have been subjected to injustice in the earth, that they will become heirs and leaders of the earth. Promise has been established in Quran for those who have Iman and Amal Salih. لَيَسْتَخْلِفَنَّهُمْ فِي الْعَارِ. That they will be made heirs and leaders and established in the earth. Their deen will be established and their fear and sense of insecurity will be transformed into peace and security. Tawheed will be established. يَعْبَدُونَنِي وَلَا يُشْرِكُ بِي شَيْئًا. This is Quran over and over predicting and promising and establishing this very fact and reality. Ahadith and Sunnah of our Nabi and Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam explains how this goal, this ultimate aim of all the prophets will be achieved, because it's not being achieved yet. Where in earth justice is established? When? Where deen of Islam alladhi irtada lahum has been prevailing and victorious over everything else? Where? When? When oppressed and mustazafeen have been given opportunity to be leaders and heirs of the whole earth, Allah? Never. Therefore, ahadith, and again mutawatir ahadith, establishes this fact that this ultimate dream, this ultimate divine promise will be materialized in the last part of the times through someone by the name of Mahdi. وَالْمَهْدِيُّ مِنَّا أَهْلَ الْبَيْتِ.
اللهم صل على محمد وعلى محمد.
In short, I would like to say the theory of final victory of truth, which is philosophy of Mahdaviyya, is not creation of Shia. It is Quranic idea. And I don't want to repeat all my discussion last night. Quran does not believe as some people believe خير القرون قرني, that best of the times is my time. Quran says no, the best of the time is still to come. We are not slipping down, we are moving up. Quran is optimistic. Quran is promising great future for haq and truth and oppressed. Quran is giving hope. And this hope is basically foundation of our belief in Mahdi. Ahadith of Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam, overwhelmingly, I don't want to repeat. From the hadith which say, Man mata walam ya'rif imama zamanihi mata maitatan jahiliya, which we explained in detail last night. To all other ahadith, where great Sunni ulama and scholars, including muhaddisheen of our own time like Albani, have regarded ahadith about Al-Mahdi, yasilu ila hadd tawatur, it reaches to limit of tawatur, means it is impossible to deny or dispute. Therefore, brothers and sisters, concept of Mahdi is a Quranic concept. Concept of Mahdi is prophetic prediction and command, in fact. I didn't get a chance to read all those ahadiths. In one of the ahadiths, Prophet says that there will be people who will be preparing for Mahdi. When they call for help, it is your responsibility to respond. Walau habwan ala sarj, this is the wording. That even if you have to crawl over ice and slabs of snow, you have to do to reach to those people who are preparing ground for appearance of Mahdi. عليه الصلاة والسلام صلوات على محمد وعلى آله.
اللهم صل على محمد وعلى محمد.
عند رواية ابن ماجه صححه الألباني, which says that Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said, how you feel كيف أنتم وابن مريم فيكم, how you feel, you people, O Ummat of mine, O Ummat of Islam, how you feel? That son of Maryam is among you. Jesus is among you. Wa imamukum minkum. But Imam of your Jama'at is not Jesus. Imam of your Jama'at is from yourself. Is Al-Mahdi. Salawat ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad.
Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad.
We left on this point last night. I need to a little bit go further tonight, inshallah. I need to really respond tonight to certain issues, because on social media and so on, regularly people make this our belief and faith in Mahdi as a point of contempt and a point of, you know, nasty comments and degrading and so on and so on. And unfortunately, those people who make comments, I feel sorry for them. Not because they don't know what is Shia. I wish they would have known what is Sunni history and Hadith. Salawat ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad.
Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad.
Let me just very, very quickly answer the very first issue which they speak about. Okay, Mahdi, we believe, all of us believe in Mahdi. Quran speaks about it. Prophet has spoken about it. Ahadith, according to, not any Shia scholar, but according to their own scholars, they have compiled 51 ahadith speaking about coming of Mahdi, appearance of Mahdi, zuhur and khuruj of Al-Mahdi alayhi salatu wassalam. This is beside those ahadith which speak about how Mahdi will look. I given a little bit, one or two sentences last night, those beautiful sentences, how beautiful he will be. Ismuhu ismi, his name is my name. Allahu Akbar. He will look like Prophet himself. Where he will appear? What are the signs? What he will do? Details, details are there. 51 ahadith only directly related to the very existence and for sure appearance of Mahdi before Day of Judgment. It is there. But now, where the difference comes, where the problem comes, where we have to really unnecessarily again fight with each other and cut each other's throats and kill each other and promote hatred against each other and ridicule each other, for what? On what? When Quran is like that and Hadith is like that about man. Where is the difference? The difference is, my brothers, let me tell you quickly, for your information, and decided in these few nights to really clarify this concept of Imam Mahdi alayhi salatu wassalam. The difference is basically, brothers, is about ID of this Mahdi, address of this Mahdi. They don't dispute our brothers. We love them, we respect them. They don't dispute Quranic promise. They don't dispute prophetic prediction. No doubt it is there. Mahdi is there. The problem is, who is Mahdi? According to majority of our brothers, ulama and scholars, in their opinion, and we respect it, they believe that Mahdi is still to be born. But indeed he will be from Ahlul Bayt, no doubt about it. I read already a lot of hadith from you which says, Al-Mahdi minna Ahlul Bayt. Mahdi is from us Ahlul Bayt. And not broader Ahlul Bayt very clearly, because again, you know, there's a tendency that if you talk about Ahlul Bayt, then to bring again the center of Ahlul Bayt down, they try to expand this circle of Ahlul Bayt so big that end of the day nothing left behind. Salawat ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad.
Allahumma salli ala Muhammad ali Muhammad.
And therefore Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam clarified, not minna Ahlul Bayt, min wulad Fatima.
Allahumma salli ala Muhammad.
Mahdi is from children of Fatima. Not only that, further there are ahadith says, from Fatima also he is from children of Hussain. Anyway, till that point, again no dispute. Cannot be disputed. But further down, now, there is no clear situation. There is no clarity. Who is this Mahdi? From where he will come? He is from Ahlul Bayt. He is from children of Fatima. But who, where, when he will be born? Is he born or not born? No, nothing we know. He will be born one day. When, where, we don't know. Then he will take a stand against injustice and will establish justice and so on. That is the opinion of the majority of our brothers, not all by the way, majority of our brothers. What is our opinion? Opinion of a school of Ahlul Bayt. And I just want to put you in very nutshell, so these confusions really, which become source of fitna and sectarianism and hate and division, should be at least clear. My honestly intention is not to degrade them, but to present the case that what is really what we believe and what are the basis of that belief, with all due respect to what you believe. Salawat ala Muhammad.
Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad.
Once again, salawat ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad.
Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad.
What we believe? No. In our case, Mahdi is not a personality without ID. According to us, Mahdi is a completely known personality with all its geography, with all its background and history. Who is Mahdi? We believe that Mahdi, salamullah alayhi, is the son of 11th Imam of Ahlul Bayt, Imam Hasan al-Askari alayhi salatu wassalam, born in Samarra on 15th of Sha'ban, 255 after Hijrah.
Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad.
He was born on this particular date. As I said, majority of our Sunni brothers don't agree, but that's what it is. Now when they don't agree, they sometimes say that Imam Hasan al-Askari never had any children. It's not clearly recorded that he has children. And therefore you believe in a mythical, a fictional, you know, something like that character who never existed. Because Imam Hasan al-Askari got no child. Never anybody was born out of Imam Hasan al-Askari. Now, of course, we have dispute about it. While all the ulama of Shia and Ahlul Bayt alayhi salatu wassalam agree, and it's a consensus among Shia ulama, that indeed Imam Hasan al-Askari alayhi salatu wassalam has child, and that child was born on 255 after Hijrah, and he is the Mahdi, salamullahi alayhi. And you will be surprised that not only all the Shia agree, and Shia scholars, early Shia scholars to the contemporary agree, but a very big number of Sunni scholars also believe that Mahdi is born, and Mahdi was son of Imam Hasan al-Askari alayhi salam. Why they believe? Ibn Khalaqan in Wafayatul A'yan, Ganji Shafi'i in Yanabi'ul Mawaddah. And I can count. And among them is a very, very joint personality by the name of, leave it, let me talk about it a little bit later. Salawat ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad.
Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad.
Why they say? They say because we have plenty of hadith, not one hadith again, overwhelming number of hadith. Prophet said, after me, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, there will be 12 leaders. Kulluhum min Quraysh, all will be from Quraysh, all will be from Bani Hashim. And this 12 will continue until day of Qiyamah. Listen carefully, this hadith is present. If you want, I can provide you the proof. 12 leaders, 12 khalifas after me will be there until the day of Qiyamah. It is there, it's present. Now, very difficult question for some people. Who are those 12 people? They started counting. No, I don't want to go in that detail. But while they were counting, they lost the counting also. Salawat ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. Now, when we say 12, we are referring to those 12 who came in this series. And it makes clear sense that we have first Imam, and we have second Imam, and we have third Imam, and we have fourth Imam, and we have fifth Imam, and it carries on until it reaches to 12th Imam. There's a sequence, there's a system. And let me tell you also quickly here. Yes, indeed, birth of Imam Mahdi alayhi salatu wassalam was not something very public. Why this dispute happened? Why people got confused? You know why? Because Imam alayhi salatu wassalam was born in a situation exactly like Nabi Musa was born. That people were looking for any pregnant woman, because there was a prediction that a baby will be born, and this baby one day will throw the throne of Fir'aun and Pharaohs. So they decided to kill all the babies. They decided to slaughter all the babies. And therefore, similar situation in the case of Nabi Musa, it's the same case in the case of our Imam alayhi salatu wassalam. Things were not easy, and I'm not talking again without evidence. Just a few days before, a few years before, in time of Imam Hadi alayhi salatu wassalam, Mutawakkil had two children. And teacher of this Mutawakkil is a person called Ibn Sukait. Muallim, teacher of these two children. He was follower of Ahlul Bayt, but he used to hide, used to keep it secret, taqiyya. One day Mutawakkil got doubtful about him, asked him this question: these two children of mine are better than Hassan and Hussein or not? You know what Ibn Sukait said? Couldn't keep his secret. So what question you are asking? These two kids of you are better than Hassan and Hussein or no? Leave Hassan and Hussein. Servant and slave of Hassan and Hussein, Qambar, is much, much better than these two kids of yours.
Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad.
But you know what happened to Ibn Sukait? Allahu Akbar, his tongue was pulled. Allahu Akbar, and he was executed for this statement. This is the situation. Imam Hassan Askari belongs to what city? To Medina, where Shia used to live in that particular era, in Baghdad. That was the center of Shia at that particular time. But why Imam Hadi, father of Imam Askari, and Imam Askari himself used to live in Samarra, far away, couple of hundred kilometers away from Baghdad? Why? Because they were removed from their followers. So they don't have any contact with them. Why Imam Hassan Askari? Interesting, I have number of times I think already explained. Why Imam Hassan Askari is called Askari? Askari means soldier. Why Imam Hassan Askari got this title of Askari? In Swahili even they say Askari. Askari means soldier, guard. Why Imam got this title of Askari? You know why? Because Imam used to live in the area where it was base of army. Askar in Arabic means army base. Imam was not allowed to live in a normal residential area. Imam was placed inside army base. So 24 hours surveillance and control. Who goes, who comes, who meets, who gives something to Imam, anybody receives from Imam. This is the situation of Imam Askari. Salawatullahi wa salamahu wa alayhi.
Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad.
In this situation, Imam Askari lived, and Imam Zaman, Imam Mahdi was born. But as I said, overwhelming evidence is available. Imam showed to his own companions the child. People came to ask, where is the Imam afterward? Imam removed the curtain, and this child of 3-4 years old came. He said, Haza Imamukum. This is your Imam after me. Allahu Akbar. Over 40 confidants of Imam alayhi salatu wassalam were present there. And Imam showed all of them that this is Mahdi. Then what happened? Imam Askari alayhi salatu wasalam was martyred. And Imam Mahdi alayhi salatu wasalam, while he was in hiding, but having limited access to the people. In this particular time, for all of your information, I'm explaining quickly. Imam alayhi salatu wasalam, Imam Mahdi alayhi salatu wasalam appointed 4 people one after other. That's a 69 years period of time. Without going in detail, some other time I can give you names of those known as Nawab-e-Arba, appointed special envoys. They are my representative. Usman ibn Sa'id, and so on. Husayn ibn Ruh, and then Samari, the last one, 4 of them. In this era of 4 Imams for this 69 years, again, plenty of people came to see Imam, those who were confident. Not only that, through various means, Imam conveyed the message that Imam Mahdi alayhi salatu wasalam is around, is beyond. You can't have access, but he is there. Allahu Akbar. Somebody collected khums, the money which is supposed to be given to Imam. He says that I collected the khums and I was busy counting. I became doubtful. It was 500 or 480. So he thought for himself, I don't know. It was 500. People gave me, people brought homes, people got money. He collected all the money to give it to a representative of Imam. Now he is a bit doubtful. It's 480 or 500. He said, okay, let me put out of my pocket 20, make it 500 to be sure that I have given the amanat to Imam. He went to one of these representatives, 4 representatives of Imam, handed over this money to him. You know what this Naib said, because he was connected to Imam. He said, brother, homes was 480. 20 you put out of your own pocket. Salawat ala Muhammad wa ala
Muhammad.
After 69 years, Ghaibat Kubra or greater occultation started. Quickly, let me take you further. Greater occultation started. Right? Means now Imam wrote to his 4th successor that no more special appointment. No one will claim that I am the representative of Imam. Representativeship is now open for anyone who is alim and scholar and proves himself to be leader of the community, they will be the leader. No more appointment of a leader from my side. Imam wrote this letter, and after this letter, Imam said to the fourth successor, very soon, in a few days' time, you will pass away. And exactly that happened. He passed away, and then period of occultation, greater occultation of Ghaybat al-Kubra started. Imam went into, I'm just explaining to you what we believe in greater occultation. That's called Ghaybat al-Kubra. In this greater occultation, which is continuing until today, Imam is alive without any doubt. Imam is around without any doubt. But not everybody has access to him. There are people who have access to him, no doubt about it. Salawat ala Muhammad.
Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad.
Now, one important issue, let me address it here quickly. Already 9:45. Very far to go, but inshallah. One very common problem our brothers raise on this point, and I don't know how, but anyway, they say that Shia believe that their Imam disappeared in a cave, in a basement, Sardab, and he is living in the cave in Samarra, and he will come out of that cave. What a joke! Why? Baseless, thinking their Imam is hiding in a cave. What is this? First of all, let me make it clear for you. I explained to you what is our faith about Mahmadi. There was any discussion about cave? There was anything mentioned about cave? She had nothing to do with cave or basement or underground. Nothing like that. What is this cave story? Sardar story. My brothers, sisters. In Iraq, it is very hot. People in summer normally have basements underground of their houses, which is cool, which is nice. Normally people take rest in those basements. Imam Hadi's house in Samarra also has a basement. And in that basement, greater time of Imam Hadi, the 10th Imam, Imam Hassan Askari, the 11th Imam, and life of Imam Hassan, Imam Zaman, Imam Mahdi alayhi salatu wasalam, he spent in that basement of the house. Finish. That basement, because three Imams of Ahlul Bayt lived there, made ibadat there, spent time there, for us is sacred and holy. Wassalam, finish, nothing else. No one in the history of Shia has said that Imam went into that cave or basement or underground cave and disappeared and he will come out of there. Baseless accusation. Baseless accusation. Just to create a row and make fun of other people. There's nothing to do with Sardar, nothing to do with cave, nothing to do with basement, nothing to do with... It's a house of Imam alayhi salatu wasalam, where they lived, where they made ibadat. We made ziyarat diyarat wasalam. Salawat ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad.
Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad.
Now comes very important question, that ghaibat or accreditation of Imam al-Zaman, Hazrat Mahdi alayhi salatu wassalam, salawat ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad.
Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad.
Imam al-Zaman is in ghaibat, in occultation. That's what we believe. I will explain. But not only we alone believe. There are ulama from Ahlul Sunnah, I'm not saying majority. There are few who also share with us and agree with us. I promise to say about somebody very big in this regard. Who is that? Muhammad ibn Arabi. Ibn Arabi. Who is Ibn Arabi? Ibn Arabi is father of tasawwuf. who has written the most important book of Sufism by the name of Futuhat al-Makkiyah and Fusus al-Hikam. This Ibn Arabi is amazing. Not at all pro Ahlul Bayt. In number of occasions he has taken very anti-Shia and anti-Ahlul Bayt positions, let me tell you also, very interesting. But let me take you back to just last night's discussion. When we said, Man mata walam ya'rif imama zamanihi, mata maitatan jahiliyah. Whoever dies without knowing Imam of his time dies like death of jahiliyah. When he reaches to this hadith or this whole philosophy, he says and he establishes very fact that earth of Allah, this world of Allah, this universe of Allah can never be empty from proof of Allah. Salawat ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad.
Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad.
He says, it is impossible to imagine this earth empty from proof of Allah, from that link between creation and Allah. Not possible. Always there should be that proof of Allah must be present in the earth. Okay? And knowing and marifat of that proof of Allah, that hujjah of Allah is condition of iman. And therefore, someone who dies without ma'rifat of Hujjatullah and proof of Allah, he dies like that of Jahiliyyah. Salawat ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad.
Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad.
He says, impossible. It's not an issue of, please don't mix it. He's not talking about political leadership. He says, like society cannot be without leader, you cannot run a community and a society without leader. Similarly, you cannot travel the spiritual path toward Allah without leader. Salawat ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad.
Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad.
Ulama explain this philosophy. They say, how it is possible? Huh? If you go in honey hive, what you call it? Yeah. Beehive, right? That beehive cannot produce honey if there is no queen in that hive. Allahu Akbar. So how this world can produce anything without Imam in it? Salawat ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad.
Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad.
He says, no. Earth can never be empty, world can never be empty, universe can never be empty from proof of Allah. Never. Never. Never be empty from proof of Allah. Then he goes further and says, but what about proof of Allah now? Who is proof of Allah now? Who is that Imam whose marifat is condition of Imam, condition of Iman? Who is that Imam? He says, that Imam is no one but Muhammadul Mahdi ibn al-Hasan al-Askari.
Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad.
That's all. No. He goes further and he says, waqad tasharrafa. Allahu Akbar. And he said, this sinful servant of Allah has been honored to make ziyarat of beautiful noor of that Imam. Salawat ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad.
Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad.
In ghaibat of Imam, he says, he claims that I have an honor to meet Imam. I have an honor to see and experience that Noor of Mahdi الذي أشرقت به الأرض والسماوات, the Noor which enlightens the earth and heaven. Salawat ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad.
Allahumma salli ala Muhammad.
Noor Rabbaha, Noor Rabbaha. A glimpse then. Anyway, brothers and sisters, my time almost finished, so I don't think we have a lot now to discuss. Maybe tomorrow night we will continue, but let me just one or two more points to make it clear. Ghaiba, that's what we believe. Now on that issue, again, unnecessary big fuss about it. They believe in something very strange, Ghaiba. Why Ghaiba? Why Ghaibat? My brother, Ghaibat or occultation is not a strange phenomena in history of Islam. Salawat ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad.
Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad.
Not a strange phenomena. I don't know why people are. Okay, come again, with all due respect to my brother. You agree or you don't agree, you don't believe or believe in it. That's a different story. But if somebody believes it based upon overwhelming evidence, respect, don't make it an issue to fight and divide community and ummah. Allahu Akbar. When we say ghaibat, occultation is not something new, go look at that. Look at occultation of Musa. Look at occultation of Yunus. Look at occultation of other Anbiya alayhim salatu wassalam. Salawatullahi wa salamu alayhi. Salawat ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad.
Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ala
Muhammad. Once again, salawat ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad.
Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad.
Now, my brothers, question is that if you say that Imam alayhi salatu wassalam is in ghaibat and he is in occultation, what is the benefit of this Imam? What is the point of having an Imam? You can't see him, you can't speak to him, he cannot speak to you. What's the point? Look, there are two questions to answer. I don't know. I don't think tonight we can reach to both questions, but at least one question partly I will answer. One is, what is the sense and benefit of an imam and a leader who is not available, who is not accessible? What's the point? He is here or he is not here is equal. His being and non-being are equal. So what's the point? That's one question. Inshallah, we'll answer. And number two is, what is the philosophy of his occultation? What is the reason for him going into this occultation? And third question, which is very easy question, that he went into occultation in 300 and some Hijrah, now it is 1400s after Hijrah, over 1000 years past it. So how can he live such a long life? Which is very easy. If Allah wants to keep someone alive for a longer period of time, what's a big deal? Do you have a doubt about the power of Allah, qudrat of Allah, might of Allah? What is impossible? Salawat ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. Nabi Nuh alayhi salatu wasalam, Quran speaks about it. How many years? They said Dawat of Nabi Nuh was 950 years, around somewhere. Huh? So if Nabi Nuh can live 950 years, what is the problem? If somebody has a doubt about long life of Imam, have a doubt about the kudrat of Allah? That's it. That's a very easy question. I don't have to. Medical science also proved that there is no necessary condition for limitation of life. It's all those different things which come up and result in the death of a person. Otherwise, it's not necessary for someone to die 80, 90, 100, and no. Salawat ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad.
Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad.
The second question quickly and then we move. The second question, very important question, that what is the benefit of this Imam? What is the benefit of this Imam? My brother, answer to this question, of course, is very much connected to the second question, which is philosophy of Ghibat. Why, what is the reason of Imam Mahdi's occultation? Why Imam Mahdi went into occultation? Which we will answer tomorrow because that's a long question. But tonight, just to give you an idea, you have to understand philosophy of Imamat in school of Ahlul Bayt. Then you will be understanding what is the benefit of Imam in Ghaybat. If you think that Imam means political and social leader, yes. Imam in occultation, no benefit. Because he cannot lead people socially and politically. But if you look at philosophy of Imamat in its Shia theology, there it is something else. Please listen. It is something different. Political and social leadership is one branch of Imamat. Please listen carefully. One branch of Imamat. It's not all the Imamat. What I just now explained to you, what Ibn Arabi says, he says, earth can never be empty of proof of Allah. Are you with me or not? Universe can never be empty from proof of Allah for a fraction of second. Are you with me or not? That is the most important benefit of Imam. In other words, Imam is like a heart of this universe in the body. How hearts beat in the body. And this is a sign of the life of this body. Similarly, existence of Imam in this universe is like qalb and heart which beats in the body of this universe. Salawat ala Muhammad wa ali
Muhammad.
Lawla al-hujja lasawkhat al-arzu bi ahliha. Imam Sadiq says that if earth will be empty from proof of Allah, for a friction of a second, earth will vanish, will destroy, will come to an end without any doubt. Salawat ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad.
Allahumma salli ala Muhammad.
I don't want to repeat. If you remember, last night I narrated one hadith from Sunni resources which said that Mahdi is someone Allah will provide rain to the people through him. Allahu Akbar. This is the meaning of proof of Allah. You want to know what is the benefit of Mahdi? This is the benefit of Mahdi. That if rain comes because of Mahdi. Hadith says, if something green grows on the earth, it is because of Mahdi. Salawatullahi alayhi. If blessings of Allah come to this earth, it is through this wasitai faith and channel of the blessing of Almighty Allah. Salawatullahi Muhammad wa ala
Muhammad.
Someone comes to Imam Sadiq alayhi salatu wasalam, ask this question, Ya Ibn Rasulullah, you are saying that your last one, the Mahdi, the successor of yours, the final one, lahu ghaibatun, he has occultation, he will go in occultation. So he asked from Imam Sadiq, long before birth of Imam Mahdi, this question is asked from Imam Sadiq. Imam Sadiq, tell us, what is the benefit? What is the benefit of this Imam? If he will go in occultation and we will not have access, what is the benefit? Imam gave a very beautiful example. Allahu Akbar. And this example I will explain and tonight's discussion concluded, remaining inshallah tomorrow night. What Imam said? Imam said, Ghaibat of Imam, occultation of Imam is like hiding of sun behind the clouds. Allahu Akbar. Ash-shamsu wara as-sahab. Allahu Akbar. Very beautiful. Imam asked, when sun is behind clouds, do you benefit from sun or not? Indeed you benefit. Indeed you benefit. But you don't see the sun. Salat ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad.
Allahumma salli ala Muhammad.
Now, couple of very important points in this example. Please listen carefully. Number one, to get benefit from something, you don't need to see that thing directly. Allahu Akbar. Number one. Number two, when horizon is cloudy, you cannot see the sun. It is whose mistake? Is it a mistake of sun? Is it a shortcoming of sun? Is it a problem of sun? Allahu Akbar. Allahu Akbar. Or it is some other problem. No, brother. Sun did not hide. Sun did not hide. Clouds hidden the sun. Are you with me or not? If Imam is in ghaiba, it is not his problem. It is our problem. Salawat ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad.
Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ala Ali Muhammad.
That is another very important point. Point number one. Sun behind the clouds is still beneficial. Can you imagine a world without sun? Leave the clouds. Even now we are in night, right? We don't have at all sun, sunset. Sun is not shining. But so many mashallah brothers are sitting here, academic, educated. Can they tell me? Are we not benefiting from heat of sun in the night? No, even in this night when it is pitch dark, still we are benefiting from heat of sun. If sun was not around, we will freeze. Allahu Akbar. Are you with me or not? This is number one. So you see the sun. You don't see the sun. Sun is still benefits. You see Imam. You don't see Imam. Imam benefits. Allahu Akbar. And number two, clouds. Allahu Akbar. Can I say something? Allahu Akbar. Imam say, that's a theological sentence. Wujuduhu lutfun. What the sarrufuhu lutfun akhar. Allahu Akbar. Existence of Imam itself is a blessing of Allah. An engagement of Imam is another blessing. Yes, we are not privileged to benefit from engagement of Imam. But indeed we are privileged to benefit from the very existence of Imam. Salawat ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad.
Allahumma salli ala Muhammad.
Third point. Let me finish. Third point, very important point. What is that? Listen carefully. Clouds can never hide and cover sun forever. Allahu Akbar. One day will come when clouds will scatter and sun will come out and will shine full scale. Salawat ala Muhammad wa ala
Muhammad.
Alaysa as-subhu biqareeb. That dawn is not very far. That dark night has to come to an end. Assalamu alayka ya Aba Abdullah. Let me take you to Karbala, brothers and sisters. Allahu Akbar. Let me take you to Karbala. Assalamu alayka ya Aba Abdullah. Ya Sayyid al-Shuhada. When we say, Mahdi is dream of Anbiya. What we say? Quran says, وَلَقَدْ جَعَلْنَا. And indeed for every Muslim, for every oppressed, for everyone who has been killed, Allahu Akbar, unjustly, we have appointed Sultan, we have appointed someone who will take revenge. So what happened on the day of Ashura? and on the plains of Karbala, and in the streets of Kufa, Allahu Akbar, and in the courts of Damascus, Allahu Akbar. That is not something which we can ignore. It is not something which Allah will leave without account. No, Mahdi will come, Allahu Akbar. Mahdi will reappear, will take revenge of all these shuhada, will take revenge of shahadat of Ali al-Akbar, shahadat of Ali al-Asghar, shahadat of Qasim ibn al-Hasan, shahadat of Abil Fadl al-Abbas. Not only that, shahadat and martyrdom of every oppressed in the history of human being and mankind. As-salamu alayka ya Abu Abdullah. Karbala, Karbala is symbolic. Arbala is representative of all the oppressed of whole history of human being. When you say As-salamu alayka ya Abu Abdullah, what does it mean? It explains the ziyarah. As-salamu alayka ya waris Adam as-salamu. Salam on you, O Hussein. You are heir of Adam. You are heir of Nuh. You are heir of Ibrahim. You are heir of Musa. You are heir of Isa. You are heir of Muhammad Rasulullah. Hussein and Karbala is representative of whole history of truth and justice, and those who fought for justice and truth and were killed and oppressed and innocently massacred. Allahu Akbar. Ya
Allah.
Ya Allah. Can I take you to Karbala tonight? Can I take you to the place where Imam Hussein is left all alone on the plains of Karbala? When he says, Hal min nasirin yansuruni, Hal min mughithin yughithuni, Hal min zabbin yazubbu an harami Rasulullah, is there anybody to help? Is there anybody to rescue? Is there anybody to support? Ibn Rasulullah, Ibn bint Rasulullah, no one answers. No one answers. No one replies. But what he saw, that some bodies who do not have heads, moving, Allahu Akbar, moving and saying, Ya Aba Abdullah, if we would have another life, we will come and reply you. This is the call from the bodies of Shuhada lying on the sands of Karbala. And there, inside the tent, all of a sudden, mother came out of the tent and said, Ya Aba Abdullah, your 6 months baby could not bear your call. He has fallen from the cradle. Allahu Akbar. He has fallen from the cradle. Allahu Akbar. Hussein went inside, picked his baby, placed on his lap. Allahu Akbar. Allahu Akbar. What mother says? Mother says, Oh Aba Abdullah, you have decided to die. This child may die out of thirst. Before you die, please organize for him few drops of water. Hussein brings Ali Asghar on the plains of Karbala in front of these army of Abu Akbar. What he says, Ya Shi'at Abi Sufyan, in lam takun lakum dinun, wa la takhafun al ma'ad, fakunu ahraran fi dunyakum. O people, O slaves of Bani Umayyah, if you don't believe in any God, if you don't believe and fear day of Akhirah, at least be free. At least be a free human being in this world. Allahu Akbar. Hussein said that, removed his Aba from the face of Ali Asghar and showed to the people. Ali Asghar brought his dry tongue out of his mouth. Allahu Akbar. Allahu Akbar. Whole army saw this dry tongue of Ali al-Asghar. They could not see it. They said there was a revolution in the army of Ibn Sa'ad. Allahu Akbar, they could not take it. What Hussein said, if I am your criminal, can I ask you, what is the crime of this 6 months baby? Allahu Akbar. Allahu Akbar. And then what Imam Hussein said and did? He said, if you think I'm using this baby as an excuse to get water from you, no problem. Let me place
this baby on a small dune, on a sand. You come and give this baby water. Hussein said that and placed Ali Asghar on the sand. Allahu Akbar. No one moved, but there was a revolution. There was a qiyam. All of a sudden, somebody shouted, "Don't allow Hussein to take over our hearts of our soldier. Go quickly, cut the situation short." Now history says Hussein went back, picked his baby. While baby was in his hand, one arrow came. Allahu Akbar. What arrow in history of Karbala came into the throat of Ali Asghar, crossed the throat, went into the hand of shoulder of Abi Abdullah Hussein. Hussein's hand was palm was full of blood. Allahu Akbar. Hussein started to throw that blood toward his calf. Allahu Akbar. Oh Allah, be witness. I brought this baby for a few drops of water. This ummat of Rasulullah, my grandfather, what they did to me and how they killed this 6-month baby. Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar. What I must say, these are Ahle Bayt of Rasulullah. What I must narrate for you, my brothers and sisters. Now Hussein, who promised the mother that I will get water for this baby of yours. Now he wanted to take this baby, who is now a body, back to the mother. Hussein is very brave. Hussein is very courageous. But Allahu Akbar, on that stage and station, Hussein does not know what to say. History says, 7 times Hussein went toward the tent of Rubab, came back. Every time he was saying, Inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi raji'un, ridan bi ghadhabi wa tasliman li amri, Inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi raji'un. على لعنة الله على القوم الظالمين سيعلم الذين ظلموا في منقلب ينقلبون. أتبع حسين يا
حسين الله يا